2009, a hearing of the Radnor Township Zoning Hearing Board. Before we begin, we have a number of administrative matters. The first is in connection with appeal number 2789, appeal of Paul Mastropiri / Rite Aid, 237-245 East Lancaster Avenue, Wayne, PA. It's a letter dated October 19 from Donald T. Petrosa, Esquire, to the Zoning Hearing Board. Dear Zoning Hearing Board members, I am writing to respectfully request an extension of the zoning relief granted in the above reference matter. The board previously granted an extension through November 21st, 2009. Please be advised that we have diligently pursued an amendment to the zoning ordinance to enable this project to move forward. We had to appear before several boards and commissions on multiple occasions. The formal public hearing before the Board of Commissioners took place on October 12, 2009. Although the hearing concluded on October 12, 2009, the Board of Commissioners did not render a decision on the proposed zoning ordinance amendment. Assuming that the proposed amendment is enacted, the applicant will have to prepare detailed land development plans and go through the normal review process. Assuming that land development approval is granted, the applicant will then have to apply for a building permit. Considering the time that is typically involved for such a project, I am respectfully requesting a one-year extension from November 21st, 2009 to obtain the building permit. In the event that the board has a problem with granting a one-year extension, I respectfully request an extension for at least 6 months, although I am confident that an additional extension will be necessary. Thank you very much. Very truly yours, Donald T. Petrosa. Any comments on the one-year request?
Yeah,
we've been doing six, but it's going to take them at least a year.
But I still think we should stay at six.
Okay. Peter?
Yeah.
Okay. Granted 6 months. Mr. Petrosa, did you want to add anything?
No, I think the letter explained it all.
Okay. The next matter is in connection with appeal number 2809, Chuck and Marty Berniker, 107 Hillside Circle, Villanova, PA. To whom it concerns, I am writing to request a six-month extension to apply for a construction / grading permit for the zoning variance that was granted to us during the March 2009 zoning hearing. We have had delays in selection of a general contractor and anticipate seeking permits in the spring of 2010. Thank you in advance for this consideration. Sincerely, Chuck Berniker. Anybody have any concerns with respect to a six-month extension of that?
No.
Okay, 6 months. The next is in connection with appeal number 2812. It's a letter dated October 23rd, 2009 from Karen S. Volpert, 506 Glen Mary Lane, St. David's. Dear Zoning Hearing Board, I would like to request a six-month extension for the beginning of construction for appeal 2812 that expires October 30, 2009. This would make the new deadline for filing a construction permit April 30, 2010. It has taken longer than expected to redesign the addition according to the variance and to produce final construction drawings. I am currently in the process of properly applying for the necessary township permits for this project and intend to begin construction as soon as possible. Your help by way of granting an extension would be greatly appreciated. Yours truly, Karen S. Volpert. Any concerns?
No.
Okay. 6 months. The next is in connection with appeal number 2820, which was scheduled to be heard this evening, 103 North Wayne Avenue, Wayne. It's a letter dated November 2, 2009 from James D. Schneller. To the Zoning Hearing Board, I am writing to request a continuance of the appeal number 2820 that I pursued before the Zoning Hearing Board, which is scheduled for hearing on November 19, 2009. I have an extraordinary number of schedule conflicts between now and November 19, causing it to be physically impossible for me to prepare sufficiently for the hearing, and I have no assistant nor attorney that will help me with this. I therefore request a continuance until December or the next month that a hearing is scheduled. Please contact me if I may be of assistance or information. Sincerely, James D. Schneller. Any concerns about granting the continuance? Continue to December. The first application we'll hear this evening is appeal in connection with appeal number 2819. Trouty and Robert Thomason, owners of property located at 211 Stratford Avenue, Wayne, zoned R4 residential and in Ward 1. The applicant seeks to use the premises as a bed and breakfast with 5 guest rooms. The applicant will continue to reside in the premises. Applicant requests a variance from section 280.29 of the zoning code relating to use and or a validity variance and/or determination that the zoning code excludes the requested use and is permitted as of right. Mr. Canelia.
Evening. Nicholas Canelia, representing the applicant. I have some additional exhibits that I would like to hand up to the board. I've marked them A7 through A20. You already have exhibits A1 through A6.
Excuse me, Mr. Canelia, were you aware that Mr. Schneller had filed an entry of appearance and a letter in connection with the application?
This application?
2819.
Obviously, I'm going to object. I mean, he's not here, and
he's neither
he
here.
He doesn't have standing. You know, the whole.
I just wanted to make you aware of it, and you're welcome to take a look at what he's submitted.
Yeah, as I said, I would object because he doesn't have standing, and he's not present.
Do you object to us including it as part of the record?
I think it has to be. I have no objection to being included part of the record. Just object to the fact that he does not have standing.
Okay.
Yes, please.
If you'll both raise your right hand, I'll swear you in. Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. And state your names one at a time.
I'm Trouty Thomason, and my full formal name is Adel Trout Thomason.
And spell Ada?
Edeltraud.
And I'm Robert Thomason.
By the application, the board's well aware, I think, and I also filed a memo with the board that the main issue here is whether the bed and breakfast use is excluded in the Radnor Township Zoning Code. We will present some evidence as to what we intend to do. We have a plot plan and all the requirements of the zoning requirements, and then also we'll present testimony as to definitions as to bed and breakfast and some of the other items in the zoning code. Trouty, I'm going to show you what's been marked as A2, and is this a copy of your deed?
It is.
And you're the owner with your husband, Robert?
We are.
And when did you purchase the property?
We signed the original paperwork in 2003 and closed in January 2004.
And you currently live there?
We do.
Okay, and with whom do you live?
Bob and I live there together, and we've raised two children in the house. The youngest one has just left for Boston University in September.
All right, and you intend to live there if this application is granted?
We would feel very happy to do so.
Okay. I'm going to show you what's been marked as A3. And
sure.
You can lay this out here so I don't have to see it. And is this a plot plan performed by B. Duncan Hubley, a Pennsylvania engineer?
It is.
And does this plot plan that's been indicated on A3, is this how you purchased the premises?
It is.
Okay. Have you made any structural improvements to the property?
We haven't. We've done a lot of extensive gardening and work inside as far as cosmetic type work. But
Okay. And how many acres is the property?
1.08.
Okay. So it's approximately 47,000 square feet?
Correct.
And you're in the R4 zoning district, correct?
Yes.
Which only requires 7,000 square foot for each lot?
Correct.
So everything existed, included the parking spaces when you purchased the property?
It did. The gazebo, the pool.
Mm-hmm. And you have an existing carriage house there, correct?
We do.
All right. And that carriage house is a rental unit?
It is.
And it is registered with the township?
Yeah, we have the permit, et cetera.
And the permit, I think we've already marked it as A6 and it's part of the record?
Right.
And that carriage house has been used. How old is the house?
We estimate 1890.
Okay, and the carriage house has been there as far as you
as
know
long
since
as I
1890.
Know.
Okay. Now, how long did the former owner live there? From whom?
We believe Joseph Marcus was there about 18 years, I'd roughly estimate.
Okay. The surrounding area, can you describe the surrounding area? And I'll show you one of the exhibits that I handed up, which I believe has been marked as A7, which is the zoning map for the township of Radnor. Can you describe, your property has a star on it, and can you describe what surrounds you? First, how about to the left of your, or to the right of your property if you're facing the property?
To the right of us are the Charringtons, and to the left of us are Jack and Kathy Brooks. And then behind us is a five-acre parcel of land, which is undeveloped, completely undeveloped, and that's owned by Mrs. Hamilton. And Mrs. Hamilton is also my neighbor across the street, right in front of me.
Okay, and you've spoken to both, all three of those people, correct?
I have, and they all support the proposition for the B&B.
Okay, and referring to Stratford Avenue, this road here that, that you're located on, as you go further down Stratford Avenue and enter a different township, that's the Stratford train station is located there?
Right, at the corner is the train station.
Okay, and then across or behind the Hamilton property across the street from you is Spread Eagle Village, is that right?
Yes, over this way.
Where it says C2, okay. Right. And then just a little bit down, one house down Stratford Avenue is that area CO, which is office buildings, is that right?
Correct. So basically we're one block off of Lancaster Avenue.
Okay. How large is your house, square footage?
Close to 6,000 square feet.
And how many stories is it?
It's three stories. We have eight bedrooms, five full baths, and an extra half bath.
Okay, and actually we've marked as A5 a floor plan of your property. Is that correct?
It's been
marked as A5. And actually there's one error, I believe, on the second floor where it says half bath. That's actually a full bath, right?
Correct.
And how many bedrooms do you have on each floor?
We have a total of eight. On the third floor, we have three full, I'm going to start from the top, three full bedrooms with an attached bathroom to each of those bedrooms, an adjoining bathroom. And then on the second floor are five more with two full bathrooms.
Now, actually, on the second floor, you have one indicated as a sunroom and one indicated as a dressing room.
Right.
Were they converted from bedrooms into
those uses? Right, just to have something to do with them.
We've marked as A4 some photographs of the property. And first, I'll show you the you know, that's the front of your property?
It is.
And it's a wraparound porch?
Yep, 90 feet.
Okay. And then A4 actually shows some of the interior of the building as well?
It does.
And you have a swimming pool, correct?
Yes.
All right. And do you have a gazebo on the property too?
Yes. It was there when we purchased.
Okay. And you have some walking paths as well?
We do. Okay. Yeah. There's a picture on the back. Do you see that? That's where the gardens and the gazebo.
Okay. And showing it 4A. Now 4A... That just shows your property, is that correct?
That's the front of the front of the house. And what I'm trying to show you is how secluded the house feels, even though we're one block from Lancaster. We have lots of trees all around us.
4B?
The top picture is the side that faces Kathy and Jack Brooks, and the lower photograph are the gardens in the back.
And 4C?
Also the backyard, just different views.
Now, is this, looking at 4C, does that show the property behind you as well?
It actually does. You can't see it, but the five-acre parcel of land from Mrs. Hamilton is behind that.
4D?
If you pull that attachment out, it gives you a sense of the length of the driveway there. There are approximately 10 parking spaces down the driveway with enough room for every car to maneuver in and out of those parking spaces.
I believe the plan shows 11 parking spaces, which count the two in the garage, which we show there also.
Right. Okay.
And then 4D?
What I'm trying to show here is a picture of the front of the our house, standing on in front of Mrs. Hamilton's house, actually. And you'll notice on the left-hand side of the photo, the end of our property with that small white fence there. On toward the right-hand side of the photo is the driveway into our home. And then at the very edge of that right-hand photo is the, you can see a little bit of the house belonging to the Charringtons.
And then 4A, is this the property behind you?
Right, that's Mrs. Hamilton's 5 acres.
Actually, I believe that's 4F, and then 4G would be?
Those are our views from the front of our house looking out toward Mrs. Hamilton.
Again, showing
as we can see. Yeah, it's pretty covered.
Okay, and 4H?
What I tried to do on the top photo is to take a picture from the edge of Jack and Kathy's driveway to show the proximity of our two homes. And the other photo is taken to show Kathy and Jack's house and our fence, the edge of our fence.
4I?
This is taken from the TE line looking up to our house. There's only three houses in between us and the TE line.
I believe it would be Tre Different line.
Thank you.
TE is a school district, right?
Thank you. And the house that starts there is belongs to the Hallorans, who are
where
the
it says family dentist, right?
Right.
And then 4J, it looks like we have some photographs of the inside of your house, and we'll just to move along.
Yep.
4J, 4K.
The bedrooms.
4L. And then M is?
A view of the house from the back.
Okay, and again, N are more views of the house?
Yes.
Again, O. And P shows interior again?
Correct.
Q, interior. R, interior. S, interior. T, interior. And U, some views of the outside, as well as V, showing the swimming pool.
Correct. With some text, if someone was interested in all of that.
Now, how did you get involved in this bed and breakfast? First, why don't you tell us your background a little bit, and then tell us why you're looking at a bed and breakfast here.
Bob and I have always had an interest in historic homes. When we lived in New Hampshire, we had we lived for 18 years there, and we had an 1803 twin chimney colonial, which we completely restored. We started on day one, and after 18 years, we still felt there were things we could do. So I just have this sense of stewardship, if I can use that term, in taking care of historic properties. I've always worked. I've raised two children. And when we came to Wayne, I saw that the house we're in at 211 and fell in love with it. We did a lot of cosmetic work on the inside, extensive gardening on the outside, but I feel a responsibility for protecting these older homes.
Now, as to the bed and breakfast itself, would you be serving meals, or what meals would you be serving?
Only as the name implies, just breakfast.
And what's the normal stay that you envision at the bed and breakfast, and for a bed and breakfast?
Typically, people come for a night, maybe two. It would be unusual for someone to stay as much as a week.
And when you charge people, do you charge them on a monthly, weekly, yearly, nightly
basis? Just the same way that a hotel or a motel would charge for it's a nightly rate.
Okay. Is it a permanent residence, or would it be a permanent residence for anyone but yourself?
Absolutely not.
Is there any rental agreement that is signed?
No.
Is there any landlord-tenant relationship?
Does not exist.
Do they have access to a kitchen?
By no means.
And, of course, you're going to be living there.
Absolutely, Bob and I are there.
Okay. What is your target clientele?
We feel that the market would be tourists that perhaps could be coming to the area, perhaps business people in the area, and particularly my interest would be reaching out to the parents of college students.
Now, you wouldn't have college students living
parents,
there.
No,
parents.
Parents of college students. There's no way that I'd have college kids in my house.
Okay. And what do you think the attractiveness?
No animal house.
Yeah. What do we think the attractiveness of this location would be?
Well, we're within walking distance of downtown Wayne. I mean, the same reason that I felt this instant attraction to Wayne, having lived 18 years on a 30-acre farm, you can walk to downtown Wayne. You can walk to Spread Eagle Village, to the farmer's market. I'm sure people would be very interested in going to Chanticleer Gardens, Valley Forge National Park. But my efforts would be to direct visitors to the downtown area.
I'm going to show you what's been marked as A8, and this is a letter from the Professional Association of Innkeepers International. Can you tell the board basically what this represents, and in particular as to the type of business that's generated by a B&B?
When I became interested in the bed and breakfast, I joined this professional association. It's the National Association for B&B Innkeepers, and this letter was provided to me by the CEO and president of that board, which represents approximately 3,000 inns. And Nick, do you want me to read
it? No, I wouldn't read it. It's, if you could summarize it.
Okay. Basically, the letter talks about the pluses, all the benefits that a B&B brings to a town and to a community. One, it attracts very upscale visitors who, statistics shows, highly educated, high income earning. And I would definitely be attracting the people who want to stay in a more upscale type home for their visit in Wayne. It talks about how a B&B is used by many, I think it's approximately 70% of B&Bs throughout the United States are historic structures. It talks about noise. I'm a very quiet, private person, and I would not tolerate inappropriate behavior from my children. There's no way I'm going to have guests in bringing noise. The way I feel about my neighbors is much too important. I would never do that type of thing. Property value increases because of the care and dedication that you give to this building. I mean, Bob and I have been fanatical. The building and gardens are impeccably maintained, and I say that very humbly, but it's something we enjoy doing. Then it talks about the contribution to the community.
And in fact, you have a letter from the Wayne Business Association in support of this,
right? I do, right.
Okay. What is a select registry, and are you going to be applying for that type of status?
There's approximately 20,000 B&Bs throughout the United States, and there's a voluntary inspection program called Select Registry. There's only approximately 400 B&Bs in the United States that reach those standards, and my intention would be to go through that inspection process and strive to reach that designation.
Okay, I'm going to show you some definitions of a bed and breakfast, and as the board's well aware, the issues here has been set out in the memo and by Mr. Ryan. The issue here is whether this use falls within some other category of the zoning code. I'm going to start, and these are the additional exhibits that I handed up to the board. In the code, as you may be well aware, there's no definition of a bed and breakfast. So as a result, we can look at common definitions to determine what a bed and breakfast is. The only mention of a bed and breakfast is under home occupation, where it says it is excluded as a home occupation. That is the only mention of a bed and breakfast. The code does refer to a tourist house, which you'll hear, used to be what they called bed and breakfasts back in the 40s and 50s. And it gives a definition of a tourist house, but then again, there is no provision in the code that provides for a tourist house use. Oddly enough, in the parking requirements, it talks about a tourist house, but there's nothing in the code that refers to the use. The only other thing, and again, you'll hear testimony, it's been mentioned in the brief also, is whether this is a rooming house, and we feel and we'll draw distinctions between what a bed and breakfast is and what a rooming house would be. First, I'm going to show you what I've marked as A9, and again, we're talking about definitions, and if you could just tell the board, you know, and where this is from and what the definition is.
This definition comes from Wikipedia, and it defines a bed and breakfast or a B&B as a small lodging establishment that offers overnight accommodation and breakfast, but usually does not offer other meals. Typically, bed and breakfasts are private homes with fewer than 10 bedrooms available for commercial use.
I'm going to show you what's been marked as A10, and just to move things along a little bit. I believe this is from the PA Tourism and Lodging Association. Again, gives a definition of the bed and breakfast.
Correct. And this one reads, a private residence which contains 10 or fewer bedrooms used for providing overnight accommodations to the public and in which breakfast is the only meal served and is included in the charge of the room.
Okay. And we refer to the tourist house, but again, it's I've marked that as A. This is A11, which refers to the history of the B&B. And this is from Guide to Guest Houses and Tourist Homes USA, published in 1981. And in particular, if you could read what it refers to as a bed and breakfast.
Okay, and what we're explaining here too is that the term tourist house is a historical one that goes back to the Depression and is used up until about 1960 from my research. During the Great Depression, tourist homes provided an economic advantage to both the traveler and the host. Prior to the advent of the interstate highway system, travelers drove through towns and stopped at houses with signs advertising short-term lodging accommodations for tourists or guests.
And again, the important thing here is that we're talking short-term.
Right.
As opposed to a longer term, such as a boarding house, would be.
Absolutely. Days at a time, a day or two even.
A12, I believe this is from the Handbook of Consumer Behavior, Tourism, and the Internet. And again, this one refers to a bed and breakfast as an owner-occupied residence that provides sleeping accommodations to a public for fee and provides breakfast for no more than 30 consecutive days. Would that be right?
Correct. And that was written by a professor at Purdue University.
Okay. And A13, this is from the Pennsylvania Mid-State Bed and Breakfast Association. And if you could, again, tell us what the definition is.
It states that a B&B is a residential property of 10 bedrooms or less, which offers nightly accommodations to the public and in which breakfast is available on premises and is included in the room rate. Commercial properties such as boarding houses, hotels, motels, etc., are not eligible for membership.
And they're not a bed and breakfast, according
correct,
to the definition.
Correct,
A14. Again, it talks, it's at about.com, and again, it refers to a bed and breakfast, the definition.
Right. The same type of definition is a bed and breakfast, generally known as a private home where a guest is provided a place to stay for the night.
Now, A15, and this is from the Zoning Dictionary, refers to a bed and breakfast, commonly referred to as a B&B, and if you could read that particular definition and also what it says it does not include.
Okay. It's a dwelling. A B&B is a dwelling occupied by a family and used incidentally to provide accommodation and meals to transient travelers and includes a tourist home but does not include a boarding house, rooming house, domiciliary. Thank you.
I guess.
Hostel, group home, hotel, or motel.
Yeah, I think I'd like to interrupt the Fennell case, which is really the cornerstone of your memorandum of law, used the Pittsburgh zoning ordinance definition of rooming house, which would be consistent with this definition, is not including what you're describing as a bed and breakfast, because that definition specifically said that lodging or meals are provided. This is the rooming house in the Pittsburgh ordinance. Or both are provided for compensation on a weekly or monthly basis. So the zoning code in Pittsburgh had a weekly or monthly gloss and would not cover a bed and breakfast. But we have no such requirement in the Radnor definition. A Radnor definition of rooming house is a building which has a dwelling unit occupied by the owner, which has accommodations for not more than three roomers. Not roomers like the spread, but people living there. And it doesn't have any kind of a weekly or monthly minimum.
Also, I'm reading under R4 residential districts. It's R4 28029C. Say that right. Accessory uses to include the following: home occupation, subject to provisions of Article 20, 280, 115.1. When you go to that and you go to D, it said prohibited uses. The following uses shall be prohibited as home occupations. And number four specifically says bed and breakfast.
Yeah, and that Actually, that is in every zone, residential zoning district in Radnor. It refers to that accessory use to include the following home occupation. And that's the point, that it's not permitted anywhere in the township. And that's the argument, is that if it's not permitted, it's excluded and therefore has to be permitted, because you cannot exclude a legitimate use. And so that's the argument there, is that it's not permitted anywhere. I think what John was saying is it's more like a rooming house. And my argument there is not a rooming house, because even though the Pittsburgh statute refers to that, in fact, that is what a rooming house is. It is something that's for longer than overnight accommodations. And we'll testify as what we see the distinction between a rooming house and a bed and breakfast is. But the Pittsburgh definition is basically the common sense definition. That is that a rooming house for something longer than overnight stays, which differentiates it from a bed and breakfast.
Yeah, I guess my view, though, is, first of all, as a board, we're to construe our ordinance in a constitutional fashion rather than an unconstitutional fashion. And that means not adding phrases into the plain language that would render it unconstitutional. Our definition of rooming house does not have what the Pittsburgh definition had, namely a minimum time for the stay. And I think within the definition, I'll read it, a building which has a dwelling unit occupied by the owner, that's this bed and breakfast, and has accommodations for not more than three roomers, people living there, period, the end. And there isn't any gloss about how long they have to be there or minimum stay or anything like that. So I think we have a duty to, if the code were genuinely exclusionary, but I think rooming house picks this up. And reference to other definitions is not, part of what we should not reference other definitions to construe the plain meaning of this definition in a way that would render it unconstitutional. So I think that we do allow rooming houses.
What zones are rooming houses allowed in?
R5.
Okay,
there may have been a reference to a tourist house from some other earlier provision.
That's what it is. I looked at the code. Yep. It was an old code that permitted in a zoning district, and of course when they changed the code, they left the definition in, but never provided for the use.
But the fact that there's a different definition that picks up the same thing does not mean that you would say, well then, the plain meaning of the words here in rooming house, which I think clearly pick up a bed and breakfast.
No, but
are suddenly it doesn't mean what it says because there's a holdover definition from some provision that's no longer being used. I think that this is a rooming house.
But we're not to throw common sense out the window either. I think probably all of us have stayed in a bed and breakfast, but we certainly haven't stayed in a rooming house, all of us. Some of us may have.
Depends what the rooming house is defined as under the code. I don't think the label rooming house, if the definition of rooming house said a store that sells groceries, you would still go by the operative definition, and you would say that that authorizes a grocery store. And so I understand that there are more common parlances for a rooming house vis-a-vis a bed and breakfast, but the fact is, does the operative definition in the Radnor zoning ordinance of rooming house pick up a bed and breakfast? The Pittsburgh ordinance did not. The Pittsburgh ordinance under Fennell had a situation where there really wasn't anything for smaller hotels, because the hotel apartment thing was a permanent dwelling place. The regular hotel was over 10, and the rooming house had this minimum 1 week stay as part of its thing. So there really was a gap. The court in Fennell, though, was very concerned about, they didn't just say the applicant gets what they want. They remanded it to the zoning board, because part of a bed and breakfast, as discussed in Fennell, was the ambiance of a residential setting, and you should not allow something on site that would be inconsistent with that. So they actually sent it back to the zoning board to evaluate what could be there in terms of the bed and breakfast and to make sure that it didn't conflict with the neighborhood.
Well, it said here, actually, looking at the opinion, the case is remanded and the board shall grant site-specific relief to the appellants.
site-specific relief to
which would be what they require, what they asked for.
They had to also say, it has, that it also said that appropriate they have to go and include appropriate conditions. So that's site-specific relief with appropriate conditions. It wasn't a blank check. And they specifically in Fennell said that but for the exclusionary thing, otherwise the applicant had argued for a use variance, mm-hmm. and the court found that the zoning board correctly found that the hardship for that hadn't made. So if this is a use variance, it's got to be a variance thing, and if our ordinance is not exclusionary, the variance, use variance standards for hardship would apply. So that's how I read it.
Yeah, and let me just refer to Fennell too. It's on page 89 of the opinion. I think I asterisked it. It says, a smaller form of lodging house that provides for overnight stays of a more intimate quasi-residential nature is not provided for in any provisions of the zoning ordinance. And that's exactly what the situation is in Radnor. It provides for a rooming house is much different than a bed and breakfast. And if I may, I'll just go on with the testimony and hit because that chart, that we have a chart in here that refers to it. And I'll just go again, we have A16B, I guess, is from Michigan State University study done on bed and breakfast, and again, it provides that it is not a boarding house, correct?
Specifically states that a boarding house or bed and board is not a B&B.
Because in a boarding house is for a longer period of time.
Right. I'll just end this. It says the people staying in a boarding house do so for a long period and consider it their permanent address. A B&B, on the other hand, provides only temporary lodging.
Now, I'm going to show you also what's been marked as A17. And just by way of background, A17 is the report from Delaware County Planning Commission when the home occupation ordinance went before it. You recall back in around 98-99, Radnor adopted the home occupation ordinance. And the Planning Commission, Delaware County Planning Commission at that time, stated that bed and breakfast and funeral homes are listed as prohibitive uses in residential districts. Such uses are appropriate for residential district and should be permitted by conditional use or special exception. And the point of the matter is Delaware County Planning Commission itself is acknowledging that this use is excluded in the Radnor Code. And that is accurate, correct? What I just, I know.
Did they hear you?
I don't know. I'll go through it again.
If I may, there's been some, what we were discussing is the issue of bed and breakfast not being included as a home occupation, and how do you reconcile that with the authorization of a rooming house in the R5 district? And the answer to that is the home occupation is an ancillary use to a single family residence. It's permitted of right and so forth. But the rooming house is here permitted by special exception in R5. And by the way, if something's permitted by special exception, the ordinance is not exclusionary as to that use. That's clear under the law that permitting something in the zoning code by special exception takes you out of the de jure exclusionary problems. But in addition to the very the single family uses in R5 that are permitted, which would pick up the home occupation, but you can't do the B&B as of right, it then comes to a rooming house, which is permitted by special exception as a separate authorized line item use in R5. So the two are reconcilable. And again, my view is there's, and to the definitions and terms are, you know, there are a lot of, you know, meanings that people have, but you have to look to the operative, in my view, the operative definition in the Radnor Zoning Code, and the definition of rooming house picks this up.
Well, that's the very point, though, John, is in the home occupation ordinance, it refers to a bed and breakfast. It distinguishes that from a rooming house, which is permitted in R5. So the code itself has a distinction between a bed and breakfast and a rooming house. A rooming house is permitted in the R5 zoning district as a special exception, whereas it specifically excludes a bed and breakfast in the home occupation ordinance. So the code itself is drawing a distinction between the bed and breakfast and the rooming house.
Except that the bed and, you know, breakfast, one could, I think a very legitimate argument, included within a rooming house. A rooming house can include a bed and breakfast. It can also include people who are there for weekly or monthly or longer periods of time. And again, our duty is as a board, I believe, is to construe this if it is legitimately construable as constitutional, in a constitutional fashion. And my advice to the board is that the definition of rooming house does not suffer from the what was found to be fatal in the Pittsburgh ordinance, namely, you know, you didn't have something for short-term guests because the Pittsburgh ordinance specifically said it couldn't be for short-term guests, had to be for a week. Our definition of rooming house does not have that infirmity.
Now, if I may, I've marked as A17, and this is a letter and discussion by Delaware County Planning Commission of the home occupation ordinance dated April 16th, 1998.
Correct.
And in number three, first it recommends disapproval of the proposed amendment.
Correct.
Correct. Mm-hmm. And then finally, down in number three, if you could read the portion starting with bed and breakfast.
Bed and breakfast and funeral homes are listed as prohibited uses in a residential district. Such uses are appropriate for a residential district and should be permitted by conditional use or special exception.
And again, the point of the matter is Delaware County Planning Commission itself is recognizing that the Radnor Code doesn't have any provision for a bed and breakfast. Finally, I've marked as A18, or not finally, I have some letters of approval too, but A18 and Trout, if you can tell the board what A18 is, and again, what we're looking at is what distinguishes you as a bed and breakfast from a rooming house.
On the left-hand side, numbers 1 through 9, what we've listed are criteria for that we're looking at in comparing a bed and breakfast to a rooming house. And the first criteria is rate. When it's a bed and breakfast, you're paying per night. It's usually an upscale, fairly high daily rate. A rooming house is a monthly rent or lease, maybe even weekly, but then you move to number 2, the duration of stay at a B&B is very short term, measured in number of days. In a rooming house, it's a more permanent stay. At a B&B, meals are served breakfast, only breakfast. It's not served at a rooming house. The type of residence, number 4, the people that stay at a B&B are guests. I don't think that's how you would define them at a rooming house.
Rooming house is more permanent. They're lesser permanent residents.
That's their home. Number 5, there's no tenant-landlord relationship in a bed and breakfast while there is in a rooming house. There's a rental agreement in a rooming house. That does not exist in a bed and breakfast, which is number 6. Number 7, there's no access to the kitchen in a bed and breakfast. I'll be serving breakfast. There's no access to the kitchen. In a rooming house, there would be. Number 8, owner-occupied. Bed and breakfast, Bob and I will be there. We're living there. That could exist in the rooming house. And then finally, at a bed and breakfast, I'm providing the services. I'm providing the housekeeping. At a rooming house, someone's taking care of that themselves.
You have some letters of support. A19 is from Mrs. Hamilton, who we said is actually across the street from you as
Correct.
Well as behind you. And A20 is a letter of support from the Wayne Business Association.
Correct.
That's all I would have at this time.
Do any members of the board have any questions for the applicant?
Would you have any employees?
I do not plan on having employees.
Okay, so you'll be doing the cooking and cleaning yourself?
Yes, with Bob.
Good old Bob.
I have a question. What sort of parking requirement would you say was necessary?
The tourist house says one per room, which if you look in the parking requirement, which is, as we said, this is really what it is. It's a tourist house, and people are becoming in single cars. Normally, you're couples or a single person. And the parking requirement says one space for each rental room. So in this instance, we have, if we're having five rooms, you have five, then you have two for the dwelling for them, that's seven, and two for the accessory dwelling is nine.
Actually,
and
we just give them one.
Well, but I'm talking about code.
I'm sorry.
And but we have 11 present. So we're required to have nine, and we have 11 on the site.
And you're compliant with all your dimensional requirements?
Yes.
And impervious and building coverage?
Yes, we are.
I'm only seeing nine on the plan.
Is there any nine on the plan? I thought there was 11.
There's nine in the...
Oh, the garage. There's two in the garage.
Oh, the carriage house.
Right.
The dwelling is above?
Yes.
Right. There's a if you look at one of the photographs in A4, the building's above.
I see.
And there's two-car garage in the rear.
Okay.
Yeah, he's had... Mr. Hughley has parking spaces required nine, and actually we do have nine showing, then two in the garage for 11.
Okay.
Here's my problem here. I'm not necessarily adverse to having a bed and breakfast. I think I stay at them a lot, and I enjoy them. I think they're a great way to travel. My problem is, like most of the times on this board, is we get caught in situations where we say yes to something, and then for the next 5 months, there's people standing in line to hit our yes over our heads. I think it is kind of exclusionary that there is no specific area that a bed and breakfast is allowed in our township. I think that's something that should be taken up with the commissioners, and I think that if not couple of the areas, residential areas, if not all of them, they should be able to, as a conditional use, bed and breakfast, if the facility allows it, like yours probably does, or so it seems, should be allowed. That's what I'm dealing with. I'm just trying to reconcile saying yes, kind of what we'd be doing is changing the zoning ordinance in some fashion. And I think that's not what this board's responsibility is. We kind of pass judgment on what the zoning ordinance says, and we let John right. do the legal one.
Yeah, and that's, our view here is the zoning ordinance excludes it, therefore it's permitted. I agree with you, the township should have an ordinance, and actually there's an ordinance, I think, from West Goshen. It's an easy ordinance to put in. You say the house has to be so many square feet, you're limited there as a conditional use or a special exception. Say it has to be over 5,000 square feet and have, sufficient parking and, perhaps a certain lot size and things of that nature. But I agree with you, that's really for the commissioners to do. And actually the commissioners have done that on another matter, which, it's a bad word here, but billboards. But the commissioners saw that coming and passed an ordinance. So now we're protected to at least some extent, hopefully, from that.
I'd like to actually discuss that case in a second, the Exeter, Township of Exeter case, which dealt with signs, because I think it's a very up-to-date expression on what exclusionary zoning is. But first, this board does have the power to declare the ordinance exclusionary if it feels that the definition of rooming house by its terms does not pick up a bed and breakfast. Now, it doesn't have to be a bed and breakfast of the size they want. The Exeter decision, where the ordinance excluded all viable outdoor advertising because you couldn't have more than 25 square feet, the zoning board found that it was exclusionary. I think it was a Commonwealth court reversed that, and the Pennsylvania Supreme Court agreed with the zoning board. But then they went on to say that the zone in crafting relief, the just has to allow for, you know, a viable amount of outdoor advertising. It doesn't allow outdoor advertising of any size that the applicant wants. It doesn't allow it to mean that you even have to accept industry standards, because a lot of stuff is put on industry standards as to what the appropriate minimum size for viable outdoor advertising was. And so there they were, you know, the court cautioned that you have to allow some, but you don't have to allow everything. I mean, Radnor does exclude, for example, skyscrapers. You know, we have office uses, but you could not build a Comcast building in Radnor.
Yeah, that's different. That's a dimensional thing, though.
But I mean, it's still whether the use is, you know, reasonable opportunity for the use is allowed. If the board genuinely feels that the ordinance does not include, you know, anywhere allow the bed and breakfast as a bed and breakfast use, not in terms of its dimensions, but the basic use, then the board should consider, it's within the board's province to say that the ordinance is unconstitutional and that therefore they should be granted relief on that basis. But I would be very cautious about doing that, and only do it if it was clear. And my advice to the board is that the definition of rooming house does pick up the bed and breakfast, and that the ordinance is not exclusionary. That's my read of the code. I understand Mr. Cornelia differs with me, but I think the code allows a bed and breakfast use within a rooming house.
Nick, you spend a great deal of time on the exclusion. I haven't heard too much about the variance.
I'll just let that stay on the evidence presented.
Okay. You don't have any other kind of a hardship that you can dig up somewhere?
We've attempted to, I mean, we can go into the attempts to sell the house and, you know, the inability to do that, and then all of a sudden Trouty had this idea that,
to stay here, but I have this huge home, and it's just the two of us, and it doesn't make sense, even from an environmental standpoint, to have that heat running, all that's entailed with maintaining that big house when I could share it and have something that's almost an adaptive reuse that...
Nick, do you think it would be futile for you to try and go in front of the commissioners and try and get some kind of conditional use for using all the your expertise, and then if it doesn't come up with a really good hardship and come back?
I don't know how the commissioners would treat it. I really don't know.
I mean, you don't know until you try. You're already at no. The only thing they can do is go up. They can't go down.
I tend to say that they're going to say no.
But you don't know that. I think that you're persuasive enough to show them that there's nowhere in the township and a township such as ours that does have the big old Victorian-type homes that, you know, it would really, would really benefit our township to have certain areas with restrictions on houses and sizes.
And I guess what it would be, John, is I'd have to file for a curative amendment, which is kind of what I tried to avoid here, because not going that route. Because sometimes when you're filing a curative amendment, obviously it's a very antagonistic situation.
Or simply go forward with an amendment to the zoning code that allows this kind of use. I mean, I personally don't get a vote here. I love what I'm hearing about this use. Unfortunately, my job as the solicitor is to advise what the law is as I see it. From a policy viewpoint, some of the larger houses that have, the on-site facilities like this house for in certain districts, maybe there ought to be an amendment to the code that allows bed and breakfast. But I think that rewriting the code the code is not unconstitutional, which I don't think it is, then that's a matter for the commissioners to, adopt through the legislative process, pursue through the legislative process.
I don't necessarily agree with what you're saying, because I think you know a whole lot more about law than I do, no question about it, but since it does specifically prohibit bed and breakfast, and it doesn't define bed and breakfast, it defines rooming house. And I feel that a bed and breakfast is entirely different. I think there is no place in this ordinance for a bed and breakfast, or in the township for a bed and breakfast legally. And I know they exist. And I think many bed and breakfasts are better off on much larger properties than R5 anyway. I think most people who would be the type of clientele that you're looking for would not necessarily want to stay in an R5 area, but would like an R1 area or an R2 area or something that, and your property is more like an R1 area. And I think we need to think creatively. I have, several years ago when I was on the Planning Commission, we were looking at ways to maintain some of these big old mansion houses without them going to schools, but keeping them residential. And we came up with the idea of allowing the mansions to be broken into two or three townhouse type units, but maintaining the exterior. And this property could be raised and have several townhouses built on it. And we're seeing that in Wayne, and I don't know that you necessarily want to do that. It's a neat old Victorian house. And I think we need to think creatively on how these properties can be reused. And I know that the zoning board should not create new zoning laws, but I think this is something that needs to be done. And maybe if it pushes the powers to be into doing this more quickly, then maybe that's good.
I agree with everything you're saying. And I'm a big proponent of old houses. I just, you know, I haven't sold properties to some commercial places because they want to tear them down and put boxes up. And I say, then my kids are never going to know, my grandkids are never going to know what it looked like before. I still think that you should try in front of the commissioners, and if you get no relief there, come back. I think they're going to do it. I can't imagine them saying no. I think that this is something we really need to have in our township. Some place in that zoning ordinance that has to say that we allow bed and breakfast.
It will take probably a year for them even to get to that point to start considering if there's so much else going on right now. And I understand, and I agree that we need an ordinance.
The problem that I see is the only they've asked for a variance, but they haven't pursued, I think the limitations on the variance and their, the fact that they're the hardship thing is.
Well, I think it'd be a hardship to tear a house like that down and put in four townhouses.
Well,
or
the question
five
is,
townhouses.
Well, look, if you found that there's no reasonable use of the property, that wouldn't be a hardship. I don't think it wouldn't be a good idea. But I think we're being asked fundamentally to decide, you're being asked fundamentally to decide to declare Radner's ordinance unconstitutional on this point. And that's a, the board has to decide that. I don't advise that, decide that. I do think the ordinance is not exclusionary. I think the discussion of bed and breakfast in home occupations doesn't affect that, because there's a specific line item used for a rooming house in the R5 district, and that is not trumped by the home occupation thing, and there it is permitted by special exception. So I do not think the ordinance is exclusionary. Could it be better? I think we've heard a lot of testimony that tonight that could be, but that's, I would respectfully submit the commissioners.
Let me just mention a couple things, and maybe this goes to the use and perhaps some hardship on the use. We have a 47,000 square foot lot. It's R4 zoning, so it's only required to have 7,000 square feet per lot in R4 zoning. You have a dwelling that's 6,000 square feet. Again, you have a very large property in an area that is zoned R4 that has been, attempts have been made to sell. How long, Trouty, has it been on the market?
It went on the market in approximately May 1st, and I can tell you that from July 10th, we've not had one person in the house. And I've spoken to our broker, if there was something I should do. And I have to share with you from the bottom of my heart, if I had thought of the B&B, I would not have pursued the selling the house. I'd like to stay. I don't have this dream to go to Sedona or to go to the West Coast, or I want to stay, but I need a way to manage with that house.
And I presume you've made alterations and movement on the price and all that stuff. You've done basically everything you can do within reason.
I've done what our broker suggested. She didn't think the price was the issue. She said there's just not enough demand at this point in time with the economy for the large homes. And now that I have my heart set on staying, it's not what I want to do.
Right.
I don't want to sell. I there's no place I want to go.
And have you been given advice by your broker that properties of this size are not at all desirable at this point?
Absolutely. And on top of it is there may be some families that come into town wanting a large home. They want a new home. I mean, it takes a certain person to tackle these old homes. There's always something. Like, you never know when you wake up what the next idiosyncrasy that the house presents. But we did this for 20 years in New Hampshire. And even though I came to Radnor thinking I was going to buy a new home, I couldn't. I wanted the old house again.
Okay. All right. Any other questions for the applicant from the board? Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Are there
much.
Any comments from the audience regarding this application? If you'd come up and identify yourself and be sworn, you can ask questions. Identify yourself and be sworn.
Okay. Karen Morrissey, I've met you in Judge Daniel's courtroom. I do. I'm a neighbor, so I'm also an attorney, but I just have a couple questions for Trouty.
Ms. Morrissey, how far are you? You're an immediate neighbor?
Yes, we're on Grant Lane. It is about three houses down and on a cul-de-sac. I didn't.
It's on that zoning map, actually.
I couldn't see it from the overhead. So if I could see it more clearly, I could point it out.
What's your address, ma'am?
13 Grant Lane.
Perhaps you could put a red, like an M or something.
Mm-hmm.
Grant Lane's up on the right side.
Okay.
You claimed that you took the advice of your broker with regard to the sales price, and I'm wondering how much you purchased the home for in 2004?
We offered $1.5 million, and it was negotiated to 1.44 because of some of the improvements that needed to be done during home inspection.
And how much was the original list price when you put it on in May of 2009?
The original price, when Bob and I had seen it, we originally saw it in the spring, was close. What's that?
In 2009.
Oh, I'm sorry.
When did you originally put the home on the market?
Approximately May 1st. It may have been a few days
It actually
later.
Went on the market about the middle of June. 1.85.
And what is it currently listed for?
1.85.
There have been no reductions in your list price, correct?
No, and our broker has not recommended that. She said it wouldn't make any difference. And with the improvements, the extensive work we've done inside gardening and the $100,000 commission, we would be losing money to... And it's Karen.
Mm-hmm.
If someone had even come to give us something to think about, but it just didn't happen.
But you never reduced the price.
We did not.
Okay. And you claim that it's a hardship, and you've only lived in the home for 6 years. Is that correct?
Right. Karen.
Or is it five?
2004, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
To the 6 years.
Yeah. And it is. I have always been a private entrepreneur. Worked small companies. Bob and I founded a company in New Hampshire. We did recruitment work. We did that for 18 years together.
And we came here. I continued that work, doing mostly recruitment consulting. Bob's retired, and I do recruiting work with a 10% unemployment right now. No one needs my expertise. I mean, I've really been struggling from the standpoint of work.
But you did buy the house for $1.4 million.
We did.
And that's a hardship. Okay. You claimed that you're going to have upscale clientele. Are you going to have them fill out a questionnaire with regard to background checks on your clientele?
No, but I have a profile, and I'd be glad to share any of the information about what the typical B&B guest is. And
but you won't have any background information on the people who come to stay?
No, but I know that approximately 80% are educated.
That's from statistics. That's not actually the people who will be staying in your proposed bed and breakfast.
True, but I'm going to be living with these people that come in. So I'm not, if there's any guests that come, I have the Radnor police, and I have other things that I could do if I felt uncomfortable. So I'm going to be sleeping with these individuals in my home. I'm going to set rates to a point where I'm going to feel comfortable that the people coming in are going to be lovely people. I am, from the bottom of my heart, I feel that people who come to B&Bs will be lovely people.
Would they be able to register online to book a room?
I believe we would use an online booking system, yes, Karen.
So you wouldn't be speaking with them before they come in?
We haven't decided that.
Well, you've already registered with innkeeping.org as a bed and breakfast, correct?
I have.
So you are advertising already?
No. It's just a membership.
But you've registered as a bed and breakfast, not as a proposed bed and breakfast.
No, actually, it does. The organization knows it was proposed. There's aspiring. Aspiring.
But that's not how you're.
What's the relevancy? I may object.
All right.
I don't think there's been any suggestion that they're having guests in. I mean, that's why they're here. So I'm not really that worried.
Okay. And you claimed that you would not be having any employees, but there's nothing prohibiting you from having employees, correct? Nothing that you're aware of?
The parking requirement might have a downward pressure on that issue.
Mm-hmm. All right. I have no further questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Question for you. Are you for it or against it?
I'm absolutely opposed to it, and so are all of our neighbors.
Okay, could we see a show of hands?
We have we actually have submitted Lori was going to submit this. It is a petition that was circulated. It was signed by 34 residents. Do we have enough copies for everybody?
Yeah, I have.
And
yeah, if you have copies for all the board. Oh, this is okay. This is, do you have
By a show of hands, how many of the objectors are Radnor residents? Okay, thank you.
We also have supporters here.
Okay.
This should be, I guess, labeled as a protest exhibit. Is this a folder of exhibits?
And ma'am, would there be somebody that could summarize general tenor of the objection?
We were going to go. We have three people that were. They're not labeled.
You have to label them like.
Okay. Well, if you just want to.
P1, P2, P3.
All right. I'd be
like
happy
that.
To take them out of the folder for you and mark P1 on there for
you. Could identify them as we go through.
I don't want to submit all of them because this is actually Lori's presentation. I don't want to steal her thunder.
So
but
she would
the
be
petition,
the appropriate person to mark.
Right. And I would like to submit the petition, if you could take it out of your folder and mark it as, what are we?
P1.
P1, which is signed by 34 of the residents, which include residents on Grant Lane, Hedgerow, Stratford. I believe the only residents who are in support of this are directly across the street, Ms. Hamilton, who has I don't know how many acres, and her immediate neighbors, who, if you are driving down Stratford, Are the Charingtons the ones in the big house? I don't know. On the corner of Eagle Road and Stratford, there is a, what's it called? Like an office park right there, right behind the farmer's market. So they're very close to the commercial area. We are on two small cul-de-sacs right off of Stratford. It's a very small neighborhood of Hedgerow and Grant Lane. It's a very small neighborhood, very close to the commercial parks at the end of Stratford on both ends.
Is there a concern that the proposed use is much more intense than the office
yes.
use that's already there?
Yes, because we have
okay.
such a small neighborhood that we feel that we have to protect from any additional commercial use and additional people coming in. We're very concerned about the foot traffic. There's several small children on both streets. I have three small children. Our neighbors next two doors down have two. Across the street, they have three. A couple doors down, they have two. I mean, there's a lot of children. Right next door, there's three. There's a lot of small children. And to have a bed and breakfast with strangers coming in, we just don't think is in the interest of the neighborhood.
Okay.
And so is it his turn to rebut, or is it our time?
I was going to ask a question.
Okay.
I've shown what's been marked as A7. And here's Grant Lane here, or if you can just point to
13.
Where you're, say you're, okay, you're there. Can you see the house from where you're located?
I'm three houses in, so all I have to do is walk one house up and you can see it.
Walk up to the corner, three houses up?
Just about.
Okay, so you're on Grant, so you're probably a couple hundred feet away.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay.
Or Gloria?
Any other questions, Nick?
No.
Okay. If you'd identify yourself and be sworn.
I do.
And say your full name, please.
Gloria Romica Johnston.
Spell Gloria.
Gloria, G-L-O-R-I-A, Romica, R-O-M-E-I-K-A, Johnston, J-O-H-N-S-T-O-N.
Before we proceed, I've just marked page P1, that petition is three pages. So
okay.
That's the only thing that's been entered into the record of that poll.
I'll try to make this very short. My name is Gloria Johnston. My family and I have resided at 17 Grant Lane for 22 years. I have lived my entire life in Radnor Township. So I'm not only concerned with our neighborhood, I'm also concerned with the township. We are all here tonight, whether we're Tredyffrin residents or Radnor residents, because we were told that it does not matter that they are not Radnor residents, they are in the neighborhood, to oppose the request for this variance. We are a zoned residential community of 31 homes. We're really tucked back in there. And we've had to deal with two townships and two counties for many years. But we've always worked together for the interest of our neighborhood and to ensure the safety and quality of life in our community. You've all gotten the packet of information. So I'll try to be as quick as possible. There are approximately 5 acres of undeveloped property behind 211 Stratford Avenue, which has already been discussed. And there's an access road to that property that's directly adjacent to 211 Stratford Avenue. That property is also owned by Mrs. Hamilton. We researched 9 issues with regard to the variance and the zoning codes. And we are concerned that this is a commercial business that will be opening in our neighborhood. And this would dramatically change the makeup of our neighborhood. We are concerned about transient guests coming in with the number of children that have already been addressed. We are concerned with traffic because we get overflow from the Stratford train station already with parking. And you can't tell me on a weekend if extra cars show up from the Villanova's kids coming to children coming to visit their parents that there could be an issue with parking. It was already talked about how long people are going to stay. We live in an area where there are a lot of corporate offices, and a lot of people come in to work at these corporate offices. And who's to say they're not going to want to come in and stay for a month because they want a homey environment? So this raises concerns about people walking around our neighborhood. It was already addressed about the sale of the property. We're very sorry that the property is not being sold, but that is not our issue. Our issue is keeping our neighborhood safe. One of the big issues that I was researching is that there are currently 35 homes in Radnor Township for sale right now that would fit this description, and an additional 15 new homes that are currently on the market. There's actually a few homes. There's one in the Trianon development up by Villanova University that would be an excellent opportunity for somebody to do a bed and breakfast. My concern is for the township that if you can't sell your house, if you've approved one variance for the use of a bed and breakfast, then anybody else in the township that can't sell their house will come in and request the same. I think 50 homes in the township is rather large, and I'm sure a lot of people would like to either sell their home or cover expenses to keep it on the market. So in conclusion, as our neighbors have come tonight to show support, we do not want this bed and breakfast in our residential community. We understand we're tucked in between two commercial areas, but that doesn't take away the right of us to retain our residential neighborhood. Thank you.
Ms. Johnston, you bought this purple folder was handed up.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, the only item that's been submitted into the record is a petition.
Submit the packet of the real estate listings that were given to me that are on the computer.
Let's do this. Let's go through the packet, okay, item by item, and each item that you'd like to.
May I bring someone else up that took the pictures?
Sure.
Okay.
Because the things are not stapled together, so we need to know how many.
Unfortunately, we've never been to one of these before, so we don't know that. You asked a question about how close Karen Morrissey's house is. We currently have two bus stops that are within feet of that house, a bus stop for Radnor and a bus stop for Tredyffrin. And Lori, I guess you have to get sworn in.
I think they wanted me to mark exhibit.
Yeah, I think you need to be sworn in.
Lori.
Yeah. Yeah.
You do solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give, if you the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the
truth. I do.
And state your full name, please.
Laurie, L-A-U-R-I-E, Cooper, C-O-O-P-E-R, Brogan, B-R-O-G-A-N.
Basically, if whatever documents you want to put in, just for example, I've got in front of my packet something, issue one, this list of issues.
Okay.
If they're separate documents, just we'll just label them.
Okay.
For example, if this particular document here is a one pager, we'll make that P2. Okay, then whatever, just do it in order, and they can be bought, put, given in. A set of these should be given to the applicant, though.
You want these right here,
okay,
all the homes, you want that labeled what?
We have, we're up to P1. Have you got it? That be P2 now?
Yeah. Okay, so this would be P2.
Just so everybody knows, P is protestant.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know what I would like to suggest? There's a lot of materials in this folder.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we have the petition separately. Why don't we just make the whole folder T2?
Do you have any objection to that?
That's great.
Nick, do you have any objection to doing the whole folder as P2?
It's a whole lot of.
Is that the homes?
Yeah, it's got the homes, it's got their issues list.
It's all our issues concerning.
Here you go.
I don't have anything.
Yeah. Yours is right there, Nick.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the easiest way to go.
Yeah, that's great.
That's fine.
You want to take a look and let us know if you're okay with that, Nick?
I have no problem with that.
Okay.
We'll just put the Does everybody have the pictures that we have, that we've submitted? It's in the folder. It's probably not, it's every issue had a picture with it.
Do you want to walk us through the pictures?
Sure.
I mean, if it's important to the opposition.
When Thomason said that this is secluded, I can drive by.
Okay. So the folks can.
I can drive by, and there's my Expedition rear mirror, which you can see. I can see the house right there. It's not in a secluded area. It's very visible. And it's also visible. You're sitting on the porch to the corner, which, can I move another photo?
Yes, please.
To the bus stop. Mm-hmm. This picture was taken from the front of the Thomason's house. There's a stop sign. There's a bus stop. That's the TE bus. It's clearly very close. Okay, this is taken Grant Lane. That's another bus stop. That's the Radnor Township. This is Stratford Avenue. You can see the sign. This is another picture showing that there's the road, there's the house. It's not nestled down into a private area. Everybody can see it. I think that's all. That's basically all the photographs, but it is not a secluded area.
Okay.
And like we said before, we are concerned for the welfare of our children, because if they're sitting on the porch sipping tea, as she has described when she wanted to sell her house, they can sip their tea and watch our children get off the bus, on the bus, mm-hmm. in the morning. And how many people have children here? Grandchildren, where your children are going to get off the bus. You hear it all the time. They're snatched from the bus stop. But you have transient people.
I think we're getting a little.
Well, this is just scare tactics now.
These are our objections.
Okay, but you'd have the same issue with the office park. I mean, that's a more transient use than what's being proposed.
There's
these folks are coming and staying.
There's not a bus stop there.
Okay.
Do you know the addresses of this plot plan you gave us of these houses, and where the people who signed this are relation to these houses?
I do. I mean, would you like me to put the name?
No, I don't need the name. I just need the number.
Okay.
I mean, I know that the one in red is 211, right? Isn't that
Correct.
What that is, 211?
Correct.
Okay, so 351 is what? You could just
number 13 on Grant was identified as, I guess, Morrissey's home.
Okay, we have 14 Grant Lane.
Well, yeah, I'm just looking at the map you gave us here, right?
There's two of them.
Okay, where is Grant?
I don't think it's on her map, but I can show you one.
I'm looking at this map you gave us.
Okay, that's strictly Radnor. Because it's split in half, you have to go to the TE side and the Radnor side.
I'm looking for the addresses of the people that signed that are on this map.
Yeah,
it's 351, which is just north of the property. Because the other one's the doctor's office, right?
I don't think the ones on her side are Stratford Avenue. No one signed the petition, unless I'm mistaken.
What are you talking
about?
On her side. Between Grant Avenue and her?
Yes.
Which I didn't see it, I'm sorry.
That's kind of what I'm looking for. I'm looking for the addresses.
Here it is. It's on the petitions. That would be 231.
Where's 231?
In other words, 351 is what? See the number that's on that plot number on your map?
Right.
Okay, what would that address be?
Okay, I see what you're saying. On this particular plan, it's just highlighting the 211 Stratford Avenue from the Delaware County Courthouse.
Okay, well, what's the property directly north of it? Do you know what its number is? See, it says 351.
That would be John Brooks.
I just need the number.
He didn't oppose it next door, 352.
He didn't oppose it.
No, correct.
Okay, he's
right. How about 352?
He opposed.
And what was his number? What's his house number?
352.
No, that's not 352. That's the plot number. What's the house number?
It's
231.
That's not the owner of the property, I believe. Is that right?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
You're talking about 235.
And in other words, that's the only one? He's the only person?
Yes. The other two properties are owned by...
I'm sorry?
The other two properties are owned by Dorrance Hamilton.
Okay.
Mrs. Hamilton.
So technically, Mrs. Hamilton owns... the property says 341-001, which is that 5 acre. Are you Mrs. Hamilton? No? You raised your hand. I thought maybe.
We have a letter from her.
No. The lady behind you raised her hand. I thought maybe she was Mrs. Hamilton.
I raised my hand. Just checked my husband's house facing the street, but I don't know.
He's assessed at Grant Lane.
And I understand that, but his house faces Stratford Avenue. We have a resident on Grant Lane whose house actually faces Stratford Avenue.
Okay.
The way it's constructed. So he's looking at that home is looking directly across the street as well to the Victorian.
Okay. But Mrs. Hamilton owns that property. It's 349-001, which is the 5 acre lot.
Correct.
Correct?
Land only. Correct.
Right, there's nothing there.
Correct.
And she owns the properties across the street, and 349 is a doctor's office, a dentist office.
Dentist office. Right.
That's different.
That's different.
Yes.
Is there anybody who abuts this property that opposes it? I think that's where you're going, right, Charlie?
Yeah.
Anybody directly abutting the property oppose the application? Okay. All right. Do we need to go through the whole map? Okay.
Is there anybody here who is in the neighborhood that favors it? Raise your hand, please.
Okay.
I see no hands.
Was there anybody present?
Is anybody here who is present now and lives in the neighborhood in favor of the bed and breakfast?
Sir, if you'd come up and identify yourself and be sworn.
I do. John Wilbur Collins Brooks. I'm at 227 Stratford Avenue. The property is directly next to it. Also, I guess in full disclosure, I'm also a board member of the Wayne Business Association, and I'm chairman of Radnor Studio 21, public television station. I'm not opposed to it, but I also have a degree in hospitality management, so I could help you with that definition between a boarding house, a rooming house, a hotel, an overnight guest house, and a tourist home. It was probably on my freshman reading list about properties and hospitality.
Let me just stop you there. Where did you get your degree?
James Madison University,
okay.
Harrisonburg, Virginia.
Very good.
I think what happens, and these are all my neighbors and friends. We live in the community, and we are in the community. And I understand their concern for children as I'm concerned about the children. I'm concerned about the traffic on Stratford Avenue. But that's not a problem of the Thomasons, and it's not a problem of how many cars I have in my driveway or don't have. It has to do with ordinances, traffic,
and all the other issues that we have in Radnor Township because of success. We have a lot of transient people that walk up and down every day from the train station up to the office park. That's also not the Thomason's issue, and it's not my issue. It's not my issue that it's a dark street, and the township has made it that way. My issue is, what's the best use of the property, and what's the best use of the big old homes in Radnor Township? I don't want to see it torn down and turned into a townhome, but if that is the way it goes, my house will be sold the same way.
Or in this case, six townhomes.
That is correct. Six townhomes, and they can have my lot if the price is hit as well, and include my house in it. I would do that. My concern is about the best use of a property, and having stayed in bed and breakfasts from Newport to Colorado, my wife broke her leg in Colorado. We stayed in a bed and breakfast because the doctor came and visited it every day. You're in somebody's home. We have a beautiful hotel in Radnor, the Radnor Hotel, going through a renovation. We had our wedding reception at the Radnor Hotel, and the Wayne Hotel is where we spent our honeymoon. I'm aware of the alternatives, but there is no bed and breakfast. Now, whether that's a misuse of the zoning or not isn't my decision. That was the decision of a board prior to this board. My only decision is whether or not it's right to have a bed and breakfast in that area, which may house at any given time, if they were totally financially successful, possibly five families. They've got parking for more than enough cars. So what's the best use of a property in remembering that these people are going to have these people in their home as a guest? They're better souls than I am, because after 4 or 5 days, I don't want my own siblings and my residents with me. I'm in favor of this for a number of reasons, and I'll just summarize it by saying I think that it's time the township show people that we do have a wonderful area. It's a walking distance to not only the farmers market, the redesign of Eagle Village, and also the downtown Wayne. And I'm proud of the community. I obviously serve in the community in a number of capacities, and I am really shocked that a bed and breakfast isn't in the township or was never allowed. Definition or not, it's obviously to me, if there was allowed, you'd already have one. Thank you.
Any of the members of the board have any questions for Mr. Brooks? Ma'am, you had a comment?
I'd like to ask Mr. Brooks a question.
Okay, if you'd come up and be sworn.
Margaret Rushman.
And spell that?
M-A-R-G-A-R-E-T. Rushman, R-U-S-C-H-M-A-N-N.
Okay.
My question for you is, it would be my viewpoint that there are a large number of possible buyers of your home who would view it as a starter-type home for a young family with young children. If I were buying a house with young children, which I do have two young children, I would not even consider buying right next door to bed and breakfast. And in basic supply and demand, if you're taking out of the equation a whole bunch of buyers, your house value will go down. How do you feel about that?
Well, as I said, I feel my house value would go down far more if it was next to a cluster of six townhomes. And so for me to protect the property, if given the alternatives, certainly I wish the Thomasons well when they put their house on the market. I wish them success in moving onward with their lives where they wanted to go. I was hopeful that an NBA star would buy the house so that I could go to basketball games for free. None of those things happened. So out of the alternatives, having a bed and breakfast that certainly would not be utilized 100% of the time, I don't think that it's going to affect my property value in a negative way. And by the, my house is a starter home by all measures. But my property is big enough that if they wanted that for the townhomes also, they could build 8 or 10 there.
Assumption that this can just go to townhomes. Doesn't that have to be rezoned?
No, because the minimum lot size in that area is 7,000
square feet,
and they have a 47,000 square foot lot.
And there's also 5 acres that's open land behind it. So there could be a large cluster of townhomes in there if Mrs. Hamilton decided that that's the direction that she wanted to take with her property.
That's kind of what I was
is a collective group also.
When I was asking about
and that
people.
Fears, that's my fear more. When I bought the house, all of the land was congruent. We were separated. Those lots were separated from this house originally. and it ran all the way down, and all the lots were opened up. Now you'll see it, and there's lots of fence lines and property, and everything has been cut up. It's not the same neighborhood I moved into when I moved in there, but I also know what the alternative could be. The alternative could be high-density housing in that area, close to the commuting lines. Yes, it would be starter townhomes, or it would be retiree townhomes. And I would hate to see the neighborhood go that way more than I would where it's a bed and breakfast, and I do know what kind of people stay in a bed and breakfast. Me.
Well, I just, for the record, I feel as though his property...
Excuse me, can you keep your voice up? I'm having trouble.
Okay, I'm sorry. I feel, for the record, that property values in our area would go down significantly, and I think you have to weigh that when you consider the benefits that accrue to the neighborhood. Whether you think yours will go down or not, I think ours definitely will go down, and I think a lot of people will exclude themselves from the area. I think that's very important to keep in mind here. And I remain concerned about that back lot, and if this does get some sort of commercial operation there, it's not going to be, it's a variance or whatever, I don't know, I'm not a lawyer, but I do remain concerned that this commercial aspect encroaches on this neighborhood. We have a good neighborhood, we have a lot of children, it's close-knit. And I really believe that if you want to have a bed and breakfast, it should not be just ordained because this person has a nice house. There are plenty of people that would buy this house. It's a beautiful home. If it's the right price, people will buy it. I'm sorry, it's a slow market. We bought our house in 2006. We're already underwater probably in our house. But I'm not going before you to tell you I have economic hardship. So I just think it's an unreasonable request on the rest of the community.
Just in response to Margaret's, I wish I'd bought in Cape May before the townhome or the bed and breakfast went in there. I'm very close to the Ocean City community, and I wish I'd bought right next to the bed and breakfast down there. It did not decrease property values. It increased property values. If anything, it's because people want to come and see that area. I think we have a lot to offer for people to come and see, and that's why I believe introducing it that way with people that are in the community would be a real positive, not a negative. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Any go ahead, Nick, please.
I'll just request my exhibits be made part of the record.
Okay, thank you. Final comments.
I just wanted to point out, Mr. Falcone was looking at the map that was in the folder of P2, and the property at issue is in red, but if you look at the surrounding properties, Mrs. Hamilton owns the majority of those surrounding properties. I believe it's 347-001, 347, 348, and then the lot behind. But Mrs. Hamilton, while she may be in support of it and may have submitted a letter, she is not here tonight. Mrs. Hamilton is rarely at home. She's hardly ever there. And she is getting up in years, and who knows what's going to happen to that property when Mrs. Hamilton no longer owns the property.
That's kind of what my concern is. My concern is that Mrs. Hamilton, from my understanding, is in her 80s. Although Mrs. Hamilton may never dream of selling the 5 acres behind them or the lots across the street or all the lots that she does in fact own, if she passes away, I'm not so sure if she has any children that they would be as attached to the area as she may in fact be attached to the area. So their tendency might in fact be, hey, look, you know what? Let's just sell as a package and we'll put a bunch of houses on it. And that's my concern. My concern is that the house, you know, the house could potentially be torn down. And then what will happen is you'll be in front of this board again saying, we don't want the townhouses, and we're not going to have any say-so because they have a right to build townhouses there. So instead of you having some people that may be staying there once in a while, you're going to have 100 people there.
With their cars.
Well, I don't believe that there is any request to build townhomes or anybody planning to build townhomes on that property. And I have to say that I think it's, you know, a rich argument to argue that it's a hardship to have purchased a $1.4 million house only 6 years ago and never reduced the price over since May of 2009 to never have reduced it. I've talked to several real estate agents who work in the same office as their broker in the Prudential Fox and Roach in the Wayne office who have said that it is ridiculously overpriced. It is not worth $1.895 million. If you go on MLS and try to find another house for that value.
All right.
Thank you.
I just rely on the memo that I handed to the board. I don't think you have to hear anything else.
Thank you. And we're going to close comment on this matter.
Do we want exhibits have to be moved in?
Yes. If Nick's moved his in. You
so
move.
We'd like to move our exhibits into the record.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do we want to clock us out? Sure. We're going to take 5 minutes to talk about this in executive session. probably around 3 miles away. And so an objection has been raised as to Mr. Schneller's standing.
That should probably be marked P3.
We'll mark this P3. Yeah, okay. I'm going to take this one. I think we're in a position where we are having to choose between what is probably the right thing to do and what we are constrained by the law to do. In my view, I agree with the advice of our solicitor. I do not believe that this the bed and breakfast prohibition is exclusionary. I believe that it is the use of rooming house makes it so, permits it, makes it non-exclusionary, I should say. And so I would not agree with the applicant on that point. I also don't believe that a hardship has been sufficiently established to warrant a variance, so it would be my view that the application should be denied. Kathy?
I don't agree with you, and I'm going to vote for the rooming house.
Okay.
I agree with Kathy, and I would vote for granting a and I think there is a hardship. I would grant a variance for section 280.29 of the zoning code.
Okay. Peter?
I understand bed and breakfast, and I am supportive of the concept. I am in favor of your proposal, but I think two things are wrong. One is that I don't feel there's been a hardship proven, and I think we're restricted by law as to what we can say, and so I vote no.
Okay. That we have a 2-2 vote, which means that the application is denied. Next matter we'll consider is appeal number 2821. Applicant proposes to attach its antenna arrays to the existing support structure in Radnor Township's municipal property, the property located at 301 Ivan Avenue, and to locate its equipment facility on the property. The property is zoned PLU, public land use. Section 280.164A allows wireless communication facilities attached to buildings or structures within the R5, C2, PB, PLO, and PI zoning districts. Section 280.164B allows wireless communication facilities with support structures in AC, PLO, and PLU zoning districts by special exception. Applicant requests variances and or special exceptions from or pursuant to these sections to permit its proposed construction and use, as well as any other necessary zoning relief. Mr. Petrosa.
Don has graciously, we were going to request a continuance on a particular hearing. It was.
Certainly.
And I'm not certain of the number. It was the.
2823.
This. Appeal number 2823.
Len
Wayne, and we're going to continue it to next month, and I would grant the board the necessary time as far as hearing the case, and of course extending the time also for a written decision until 45 days from next zoning hearing.
Okay.
And Jim Levin, who has entered his appearance.
I'd like to enter my appearance so that I get notices and such for this
okay.
Case. I'm an adjacent property owner and attorney for them.
And you have no opposition to the continuance.
No opposition to the continuance.
Okay. Any members of the board have any concerns or questions regarding the continuance?
Thank you.
Okay.
Sir, you should probably leave a address or something with the...
It's on my entry appearance.
Oh, okay. We have an entry of appearance. Okay. This should go into the record. Okay.
Thank you.
So we'll continue that till next time. Ms. Petrosa, thank you for your patience.
Yes, thank you. Good evening. Don Petrosa, representing the applicant, T-Mobile Northeast, LLC. In a nutshell, T-Mobile has entered into a lease with the Township of Radnor to locate its telecommunications or wireless communications antennas on the existing tower on the township property, the existing lattice tower. The tower is 200 feet in height right now, and it's got a 19-foot whip antenna at the top of the tower in addition to several other antenna that are on the tower. The T-Mobile antenna, the center of the antennas would be at 180 feet above ground level. Verizon currently has its panel antennas, which are similar to the panel antennas that T-Mobile would use, at 170 feet. There's got to be 10 feet separation distance between the antennas. We have sought relief under Section 280-164B, which allows wireless communications facilities in the, among other districts, PLU zoning district, public land use, which is the zoning for the township building here at 301 Ivan Avenue. So the use is permitted by special exception. And there is another issue which relates to the equipment. There's an existing equipment area or compound, but I'd say area, fenced area, for the equipment that is the antennas and the related equipment that are currently on the property. T-Mobile would be extending that equipment area 23 feet by 25 feet, or a little less than the size of three parking spaces, and it would match the existing fence, match the existing retaining wall, and within that equipment area would have a 10 by 20 foot concrete pad and its equipment cabinets, up to a maximum of six equipment cabinets would fit on the 10 by 20 pad. They're about the size of a refrigerator. And they would be, if you know where the existing equipment compound is, it's just right here at the building. The property to the rear of this property is zoned PA, planned apartments. And the ordinance says that you're supposed to follow the setbacks for the district, so that the setback in the PLU for side or rear yards would be 25 feet unless you're adjacent to certain zoning districts, one of which is residential, in which event the setback is supposed to be 120 feet from buildings. The setback applies only to buildings. The existing equipment, I believe, I'll call on Robin Cohn, is at about 25 feet from the property line. That's where the existing fenced area is and the existing equipment for Verizon, and there are various township and other facilities and antenna on the property. We would be further than that. We're extending it, but at a point where our closest point from our equipment, as shown on the plan, is 29 feet 2 inches. And there are three reasons that we've cited in our application as to why that's permitted to be there. The first is that we don't believe that anything that we have there in this equipment area constitutes a building under the definition of a building in the zoning ordinance, and the setback requirements applies only to buildings. In the alternative, if it is a building, the ordinance allows by special exception accessory buildings to be in the yards, in the rear yards, so it would be permitted by special exception if you concluded that it was a building. And lastly, under the standard 280-101B, we're not extending the extent of the nonconformity. We're just continuing the line and actually coming a little further away from the property line. And that's really what the legal issues are that are involved in the case. The use is permitted by special exception, and the equipment is permitted to be there either by right or alternatively by special exception.
What are the size of the cabinet?
The cabinets are roughly the size of a refrigerator, but this gentleman, who's probably the only one that might have to offer any testimony at all, if we could have him sworn in, Robin Cohn, can give you the dimensions.
Okay, let me just, before we get to that, it seems to me that the only thing you either need is a declaration that these cabinets are not buildings or approval for an accessory building by special exception. You do not require, under the worst case scenario, you require nothing more than a special exception.
I agree.
I'm sorry. Point out to the board, there is a case of two-way towers, I forget what the township involved, where in this instance the township tried to use equipment, say that the equipment, the applicant was facing a pending ordinance, and under the Article 5 of the MPC, if they filed a land development application for buildings, they could beat the pending ordinance, and they tried to say their equipment cabinets were buildings, and the Commonwealth Court said, they are not buildings, even though they had a definition, which if I recall was very similar to the Radner Code's definition. So I think the concept that they are, if they're not, I think under two-way, it would be very unlikely they could be classified as buildings for purposes of taking advantage of the subdivision procedure for beating a pending ordinance. And if that's so, I think it's got to go the other way, too.
Okay.
And there were a few additional exhibits I'd like to hand up, and I can call Mr. Cohn to put a few facts on the record. But one of the exhibits, all of the exhibits were submitted with the application, or at least exhibits A1 through A13 with the application packet, and you should have all of those. I added a few additional exhibits, which I handed the originals to Mr. Ryan. I have copies for the board. One was exhibit A14, an affidavit of radio frequency engineer, just saying there would be any interference with other communications, emergency communications. Another, and the radio frequency engineer is here this evening as well. Another A15 is a propagation map showing T-Mobile's current on-air coverage in the area. A16 is a propagation map showing future on-air coverage with the proposed site. I don't think that becomes particularly relevant because I've read through the ordinance and there's nothing in there that says we need to prove that we have a gap, but the testimony would be that we do have a gap in coverage. A17 is a special power of attorney from T-Mobile Northeast LLC to Scott Dolly, who was here with me this evening to represent T-Mobile in these proceedings. I'll hand up the original to Mr. Ryan.
Okay, actually, I don't know if there's a copy, but the original should go into the township folder. I've looked at that, and that's fine.
Okay.
And lastly, exhibit A18, the original of which has been, again, given to Mr. Ryan, is a letter of authorization from the interim township manager, John Granger, confirming that T-Mobile was authorized to file this application and to process and proceed with the application. There are some exhibits A1 through A18. I've got an exhibits list that I would like to hand up to the board. And even though the other exhibits were submitted, I'd be happy to hand up a full set of all of the exhibits together if you'd like to have them.
Sure.
And if any board member wants a copy of any of those, A14 through A18, I have additional copies of those that I can provide.
I do. Just one second there, Mr. Petrosa. For the record, we have an entry of appearance from Mr. Schneller and a letter in opposition to the application. I don't know if you've had a moment to, if you've seen this. I presume you object to Mr. Schneller standing.
I do. I actually did get an opportunity to see it a few minutes ago. One of the folks in the audience showed me a copy of it. I did read it. I do object to Mr. Schneller's standing. Not sure the exact distance, but I would say he's got to be at least a half mile away from this site, if not more. And I don't think he has any special interest other than the general public in this particular application.
Okay. Would you have any objection to I'll mark this as a P1, and we'll give it whatever weight it is appropriate. Okay.
Can I call Mr. Cohn?
Please.
Thank you. Robin?
I do.
State your name for the record, please.
My name is Robin Cohn, K-O-H-N.
Speaking that way again, and use this if you need to point. Okay. Mr. Cohn, would you please state your business address?
My business address is 523 Kimberton Road, Phoenixville, Pennsylvania, 19460.
And are you a registered architect in Pennsylvania and several other states?
I am.
And your employer is Betzwood Associates PC, Architects and Engineers?
That's correct.
And you're president of the company?
That's correct.
We've included a copy of your resume as exhibit A3 in the packet. The information on your resume is true and correct? Is that correct?
That's correct.
You've previously testified as an expert witness in the field of architecture and in the design and layout of wireless communications facilities before zoning hearing boards, planning commissions, and governing bodies on many, many occasions?
I have, including this one. Right.
Now, did Betzwood Associates prepare a set of plans for the proposed wireless communications antennas to be mounted on the existing township tower and related equipment on the property owned by Radnor Township at 301 Ivan Avenue, right here in the township building?
Yes, it did.
Now, the plans submitted with the zoning application are dated 10-18-09, and we've marked them Exhibit A4 for purposes of identification. What is the zoning of the property?
Public land use, PLU.
And drawing sheet LS1 is titled Site Plan and Notes. It shows the subject property, the existing buildings and structures on the property, and the location of the existing and proposed wireless telecommunications, antennas, facilities, and related equipment?
Correct.
Where is the existing wireless communication facility located on the property?
Pointing to it now, there's an existing small building at the base of the tower, under the tower, and then there is an equipment building slightly to the south of the tower.
And sheet S1 of A4, the plans, shows the existing antenna support structure and the existing and proposed wireless communications facilities?
Yes.
Please describe the existing wireless communication facility, including the antenna support structure, the antennas, and the equipment that are there currently.
There's an existing, of course, the lattice tower, which is a 200-foot tall structure. There's a small terminal building under the tower that was at one time used to receive cables. I believe this is an old Comcast head end tower, received cables. And then there was an existing equipment building that is now occupied by Verizon Wireless. The entire compound is enclosed with a chain or a fence with barbed wire on top, and there's an existing emergency generator on the site.
Okay. The lattice tower itself is 200 feet tall?
That's correct.
And there's a whip antenna on top of the tower that goes up how high from there?
Another 19 feet.
Okay. And are there several other antennas currently on the antenna support structure?
Yes, there are.
Some of which are whip antennas and some of which are panel antennas, similar to the ones proposed by T-Mobile?
Correct.
And Verizon has panel antennas on the tower at this time?
Verizon has, I think, 15 panel antennas.
All right.
Yeah, the antennas themselves conform to zoning, right? The only issue we have is with these equipment cabinets.
That's correct. The wireless communication facility is permitted by special exception. The definition of wireless communication facility includes both the antennas, could be an antenna support structure, and the related equipment facilities.
What's the difference? You have here the 280, 164A, and 164B.
I thought I had, let's see.
Because it says the property is zoned PLU. Section 280, 164A allows wireless communication facilities attached to buildings or structures within the R5, C2, PB, PLO, and PI zoning district.
Right, right.
And we're not that.
I'm with you.
Right. So why is that in there?
Because the way the ordinance is written right now, it indicates that you can attach antennas to existing structures in five zoning districts, one of which is not the PLU district.
But the
next section allows antennas with antenna support structures in the PLU district by special exception.
Okay.
And although we're not building a new antenna support structure, we think that we are allowed pursuant to that section B, because it is antennas with an antenna support structure. I think to construe the ordinance any other way would not make sense, that you could build a brand new tower in the PLU district, but you couldn't attach antennas to an existing tower.
Right.
That's an interpretation.
I kind of what I'm saying, I couldn't figure out what
yeah.
was there.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Let's see. Okay, I guess we were to the point, at what height will the proposed T-Mobile antennas be mounted?
Center line will be 180 feet.
Okay, so the top of the antennas would be somewhere between 182 and 183 feet?
That's correct.
And that's about 10 feet higher than the Verizon antennas?
Also correct.
All right. Would you please describe the existing and proposed equipment area and T-Mobile's proposed equipment cabinets and related equipment?
Well, the existing equipment area consists of those elements I described. There's a lattice tower, there's a small terminal building directly under the tower, and then there's the Verizon equipment building, and everything's encompassed with a chain link fence with barbed wire and a small generator. It's T-Mobile's proposal to increase the size of the compound fenced area some 23 feet to the west and then 25 feet to the north, so that to encompass the 10 by 20 concrete pad and a small generator emergency generator for T-Mobile's equipment.
But not to exceed what's already there? In other words, to go outside the boundary lines, right? Isn't that what you said?
Well, no, we are extending the equipment area by 23 right. feet by 25 feet. So we are putting an additional equipment area right next to the current, but not to come any closer to the
property. That's what I meant.
You're not
exceeding, you're not getting any closer.
That's correct.
You're not encroaching any more than what's already.
Yes, sir.
So correct. It's sort of like a 280-101B1.
Yeah, it would be. It is. That's my third of the three arguments.
Okay.
The existing compound is, at the closest point, it's 25 feet. Okay. Our closest point is 29 feet, 2 inches, and that varies, diverges to 31 okay. feet.
Okay. But do we know whether this is non-conforming or whether they authorize it by special exception under this ordinance?
It is non-conforming. The we know for a fact that the tower was there in at least 1996. Two reasons. In the title report I submitted, there's a tower lease from 1997 with, I think, Bell Atlantic and the township. Secondly, I confirmed, and I have an email from Steve Giancristoforo from the township, that he believes the township was... The tower was constructed in 1996. The ordinance was adopted in May of 1998, the first wireless communications regulations in the township. But we think the tower may be actually a little bit older than that. Robin Cohn was involved with the Verizon application, I guess Bell Atlantic back then. And we're not certain, but he thinks it may have been around 89 or so, and it was turned over to the township. It was originally the Comcast tower, as he mentioned, turned over to the township in about 1996. Is that accurate?
That's correct. That's my recollection.
These equipment cabinets, you say they're the size of a refrigerator. Would 6 by 2 by 2?
Actually smaller, 3 by 4 by 5, 5 feet high.
Okay, 3 by 4 by 5. Okay.
And what are they made of?
They're steel, they're galvanized and painted steel, and they house radios.
Do they? You can't walk inside them, can you?
Oh, no.
Okay.
No, they're full of electronic gear.
So they're just basically boxes. You would open them up and access the things, but someone wouldn't walk inside a shack or something?
No. Like, these have access doors, and there are printed circuit boards and bits of hardware in there, but you couldn't get into it.
So as you open the access, the equipment that you need to... that you're trying to get to is right there.
Correct.
Okay. Because I think 101B1 would be an expansion of the existing structure. The accessory thing is for an accessory building, but I just don't think these are buildings. And so where I'm coming out is you probably want to do a special exception approval for the antenna facility on the tower just to be sure it's within the existing special exception. As for the, or you could prove the whole thing by special exception, but the testimony is, I don't think these are buildings.
Doesn't sound like it.
I just have a few more. Mr. Cohn, I indicated in my opening that T-Mobile was going to match the existing fencing and retaining wall. Is that true?
That's correct, yes.
So that we will be extending the equipment area. Just take the fence and extend it.
Yes,
is that correct?
Correct.
Okay.
23 feet.
And you agree that the property to the rear is zoned PA and that the setback today would seem to be 120 feet from buildings, as I described.
Correct, right? Yes.
Now, this will be an unmanned facility.
That's correct.
The existing tower already has lights at the top.
It does.
No additional lighting would be required or proposed?
No, none.
Okay. And the facilities would be designed, constructed, and maintained in compliance with the standards contained in applicable state or local building codes and all applicable standards that are published by the Electronics Industry Association?
Yes.
And the construction drawings will be signed and sealed by a licensed professional engineer in the state of Pennsylvania?
Correct.
And the construction will be supervised by qualified personnel?
That's right.
And the existing tower is capable of supporting these antennas?
Easily, yes.
Yes. Those are the questions that I have for Mr. Cohn. The board may have some questions.
Does any members of the board have any questions? No. Any members of the audience have any questions or comments regarding this application? Okay.
And, Mr. Dolly is here on behalf of T-Mobile, an authorized spokesperson. He doesn't really have anything to add unless the board has any questions. No. And Bassem Iskander, the radio frequency engineer, would say we need to have this. Bassem Iskander, I'm sorry, Iskander. He's just a radio frequency engineer who would testify that T-Mobile has a gap in the area. And
who again has the power of attorney?
Scott Dolly.
Yeah, I guess he should adopt, be sworn in and adopt the testimony as his own.
Aye. I do.
And state your full name, spell your last.
My name is Scott Dolley, D as in David, O-L-L-E-Y. Business address is 400 Street Road, Ben Salem, Pennsylvania, 19020.
Mr. Dolley, you were employed by SmartLink, is that correct?
That's correct.
And they're an authorized representative of T-Mobile Northeast LLC?
They are.
And you heard my comments in my introductory remarks, and you've seen the exhibits where we introduced a copy of the lease between the township and T-Mobile, and also a copy of the title report. And it is true that T-Mobile has entered into a lease with the township for this facility?
It is true, yes.
And do you adopt the comments that I made in my opening remarks and also confirm the testimony that Robin Cohn has made?
Yes, I do.
Anything else?
Any questions for the witness, members of the board? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Kathy, you want to take this one? Turn your mic on.
I would suggest that we grant the special exception for the tower antennas and also the expansion of the equipment area underneath.
Okay.
I agree.
Charlie? I agree as well. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to add to the opinion finding that these are not buildings, which makes it these okay. equipment cabinets are not buildings.
Okay. You okay with that finding?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm okay with that as well.
Let's, thank you very
that's
much.
That's so fine. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
The next matter we'll hear this evening is appeal number 2822. Pursuant to appeal number 2806, the applicant, Agnes Irwin School, located at 295 South Ithan Avenue, Rosemont, PA, was granted relief by the Zoning Hearing Board to construct an addition to their school which would not increase the existing nonconformities regarding setbacks. The applicant applied for land development approval and has been informed that it requires a special exception from 280-69F of the zoning code relating to riparian buffer setback. As a result, applicant requests a special exception under section 280-89.8A of the code or contends that the relief is permitted as of right since it disagrees with the interpretation that it requires the requested relief. I will be recusing myself from consideration of this application insofar as the Agnes Irwin School is a current client of my law firm.
Nick, are you handling this?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
You may recall you've seen this plan before. The only difference is when we went to Planning Commission, one of Dan's comments was that we need relief on the riparian buffer, although that was not our understanding initially. For a number of reasons that I'll go over with the board, but also all we need, even if we do need the relief requested or required is a special exception relief.
Madam Chairman,
yes.
I think we have another letter on this one.
From Mr. Schneller? Yes,
again, I will object to his standing on this matter. He lives nowhere near this property. He probably lives 3 or 4 miles away from it.
Should I label this as
P1? And I think, you know, I would recommend, you know, it being included in the file with the notation of the objection of counsel and given whatever weight the board deems appropriate.
Yes. Whenever you're ready, Nick.
Okay, thank you. Why don't you guys come on? I'll swear you in.
If you both raise your right hand, I'll swear you in. Did you sign this note and affirm the testimony you're about to give? Will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth.
I do.
And state your name one more time.
My name is Kevin McCullough, M-C-C-U-L-L-O-U-G-H.
Joseph Hanna, H-A-N-N-A.
And, starting with Kevin. Kevin, what's your position with Agnes Irwin?
I am the Director of Finance and Facilities for the school.
Okay, and I'll show you A1, and this is the deed that we actually presented in the previous zoning hearing to. Agnes Irwin acquired this property in 1957. Is that correct?
In 58, I believe.
I'm sorry, I'm not hearing you over here.
57 it is. Okay. Thank you.
And then we received previous zoning relief from this board in the way of a special exception that I've marked as A2.
That's correct.
Okay, and can you just briefly explain to the board what we're doing on the site? Again, the board had heard this before, but if you could just...
Yes, this is an expansion of the school's athletic and dining facilities and the addition of a new entrance to the school. This is on South Eithan Avenue.
Okay. And Kevin, you know, if you want to come up. I've marked as A6, or Joe, excuse me. Joe, if you can identify yourself for the record.
Yes, Joseph Hanna.
And you are a registered Pennsylvania engineer?
That is correct.
I'm marking up, handing up your CV, and marking as A6, and you have been sworn in as an expert witness of civil engineering in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania previously?
Yes.
And actually, you appeared before this board and the Board of Commissioners and the Planning Commission previously as well, haven't you?
That is correct.
Nick, can I ask a question? You have here... 280-69F, that's supposed to be G?
It
is. You're talking about riparian, right? 35 feet?
Yeah, it's riparian buffer.
That's G. It's not F.
Yes, it should be G. And actually, if you look at the code regarding riparian buffer, in particular, 280-89 deals with riparian buffer conservation district. And initially, it talks about the applicability, which is 89.5, which states that the riparian buffer is not required on properties on which streams are enclosed by man-made channels or underground, which is actually the what is going on here. Actually, is
the
circumstance
streams involved
here?
Either underground or enclosed?
The stream that is involved, we will be enclosing the stream. And also, there's already existing streams that are enclosed and underground.
Is there a stream that is presently not enclosed that is subject to enclosure here that is
yes.
causing the problem?
Yes, that's correct.
So but right now, it's not enclosed and it's not underground.
That's correct. Part of it is underground. I think we'll present the testimony.
And I guess the question that I'm if it's presently underground or enclosed. I would agree that you don't need to be here, but if there's a question about that, then I think you'd need a special exception.
Okay. And also, although under 89.6D, it also states that permitted land disturbance, and it talks about activities regulated by the Commonwealth, such as permitted stream or wetland crossings or other encroachments, and this is regulated by the Commonwealth. This is regulated by DEP that Joe will talk about. But in any event, again, if the board determines that we do need the relief, it is a special exception relief. Joe, I'm going to show you what's been marked as A3. And if you could explain to the board what A3 represents.
A3 is a plan of the existing features on the property. We have color-coded it to identify the portions of the existing stream that are enclosed and the portions of the existing stream that are in an open channel. We've also identified existing storm sewers that are along the public roads that discharge into the property and into portions of the enclosed stream.
So the stream that we're referring to is this stream...
Correct. The stream starting, I'll call it the north end of the property, goes into a culvert. It's enclosed underneath the sports fields for approximately 520 feet. Then it's in an open channel for 110 feet.
If I could ask you, the walls of that channel, are they masonry or is it a natural?
This section of the channel is a grass embankment.
Right.
It goes underneath the building and then it goes in a walled enclosure and then it goes into two box culverts which are enclosed on all sides and underground underneath a plaza area, underneath the building, underneath the parking, and discharges back to an open grass channel in sort of the lower parking field. and then between the parking lots, it's an open grass channel, goes into a culvert underneath the driveway, and then back into the original open channel before it goes under Conestoga Road.
How deep is that stream?
The
grass. Under normal conditions?
Flowing?
Flowing.
It might be a couple inches deep.
Right.
It might be a foot wide and a couple inches deep.
Yeah, why wasn't that enclosed before when you were doing the fields and so forth, taking over to the other part?
This section up,
mm-hmm.
I don't know. I wasn't involved in the design at that time. This these buildings, the upper school, middle school complex area, are 1960 vintage. So I don't know what the design was. There was probably some relocation of the channel at that time. This portion, which is in the box culvert, was constructed when they built the Arts and Science Center. I think that's about 1980 vintage.
And just, there's some pictures here. If you look at your photographs, which kind of show.
What are you going to enclose again? It's not enclosed now?
There's a 110-foot section of the open channel that's behind the gymnasium.
Okay, that's the one right above three.
Correct.
Okay, so that's what you're going to enclose. It's not enclosed now.
That is correct.
And just showing some photographs. First is photograph one, which has been marked as A4. I can just...
That is a photo looking upstream from our property to the open grass channel on the neighboring property.
And that's what we're talking about. It's maybe a couple inches. You can't even see the water, basically. It's
correct.
So low. Photograph two?
Photograph two is looking in reverse direction at the end of the culvert that takes the stream enclosure underneath the athletic fields.
And again, they're marked, so you're showing where
yes.
You're taking the pictures from.
Photo number three is looking at the outlet of the enclosure as it comes off of the athletic fields, and there's actually two pipes there. One is the culvert that goes underneath the athletic fields, and the other pipe is the pipe that takes the water from Ithan Avenue onto our property and then discharges it to the channel.
Okay, and this is the portion, at this point, it'll start being
this
enclosed.
This is the upper end of mm-hmm. the channel that will enclose.
And then photograph four?
Photograph four is looking from that point down to the existing building. That's the section of the channel that's going to be enclosed.
And what's going to be, is there going to be something on top of there?
This is where the new building, new gymnasium is going to be constructed.
Photo five?
Photo five is looking at the channel that's enclosed on the sides, open on the top, up to the existing building.
And that actually is enclosed by masonry walls?
That has masonry walls on both sides, correct.
And then A6?
A6 is where it goes into full enclosure underground in two box culverts.
And photo seven.
And photo seven is looking upstream from the lower end of the parking area, showing the grass swale.
And you show basically a little swale.
Correct.
With maybe an inch or two of water in it. I'm going to show you what's been marked as A5, if you can tell the board what A5 represents.
A5 is a site plan that shows the proposed improvements that have been submitted with the land development application, and it is color-coded to indicate the area that's going to be enclosed underneath the building. Now, this lighter green area, is 110 feet of it is the existing channel, and then these two sort of sidelines are relocation of existing enclosure.
Now, is there any impact on any chemical, physical, or biological goings-on of the property by the fact that you're enclosing this?
No.
Does it affect any, the fact that you're enclosing it, does it affect any trees or species or anything of that nature?
No, it does not.
Does it have any impact on flow or pollutants or any of that nature?
No.
How about on erosion or sedimentation?
No impact.
Any impact on any other stream, or is it near any stream that would cause an impact?
No.
Is it, if you're unable to enclose this, would it deny the applicant the reasonable use of this property? And if yes, why would it?
Yes, it would. This is the buildable area of our property. In fact, earlier testimony that we got approval for special exception to allow this construction in this portion of the site. We're restricted by the setbacks along the boundary of the property.
And is it the minimum relief necessary here?
Yes.
You're only enclosing the portion that's required to be enclosed as a result of the addition?
That's correct.
And is it consistent with the comprehensive plan?
Yes.
I have a question. Looking at A3, which is what's there now, and you have the culvert that runs from Eithan Avenue down to the, you know, past the existing gymnasium and connects with the other culvert that's running east to west, right?
Yes.
And then on A5, so you're going to take that culvert out and replace it with the new culvert?
It's being relocated, basically, and to accommodate the location of the building additions, we have to move the pipe that comes off of Eithan Avenue down to that area in a different location. So that's why we.
What building? I don't see what building.
There's a gymnasium that's in.
Yeah, there's a gymnasium, yeah, right. That's there now. The existing correct. Gymnasium, correct.
Right. So we're reconstructing this and making it larger to accommodate.
So it's not a building; it's the parking that you're going to reconfigure.
We're reconfiguring the parking here, but we have to do this storm sewer before we remove the gymnasium. So the storm sewer is going past the gymnasium. This area in here is where the gym is. And we have to put this storm pipe in before we take the gymnasium down. The gymnasium comes down.
You're almost flipping a gymnasium, it looks like, right? Almost?
Well, we're flipping it, but it's larger in size.
Yeah, I understand.
It's over in this area. But this gymnasium will remain in place while this gymnasium is being constructed.
Mm-hmm.
But those pipes that you're changing are drain pipes. They're not enclosing a stream.
That's correct.
You're picking up township water and running it into your retention system or water system.
That is correct, yes.
It already goes there now, correct?
Correct.
And it's already enclosed now.
Yes.
You're not touching the stream, you're just touching,
well, they're touching
water.
That stream.
Right. Right, they're dumping it, okay, yeah. But I mean, they're not changing the stream up here.
No.
No, there's no stream up here. We just show this to identify it as part of a collection storm sewer system that comes down to this point.
Yeah, that's not a stream there, that's just pipes.
Now, where are you dumping all that water?
Well, this water comes onto our property now and discharges to the stream. The stream runs through the property down to the lower end and then underneath Conestoga Road. As part of the construction of these facilities, we're putting large underground stormwater systems in underneath the fields, underneath the parking areas to collect the to runoff.
Retention?
Yes.
Is there any alteration of the natural stream? Presently is a natural stream on this map. You're taking a natural stream and enclosing it or redirecting it, or is this all existing swales and culverts and underground streams? Are you doing anything to a natural stream?
No, this is basically an open channel that had been modified in the past, and now we're enclosing it.
But it is a channel, it's not a stream.
I consider it a channel, yes. It has about a 50-acre watershed that drains to this. It's a 24-inch pipe that picks the water up at the upper end of our site.
Yeah, it's a pipe. It's not going through a natural stream bed. It's going through, what's it going through?
It's a grassed line channel.
Grass line channel.
Yes.
And that's the question, is whether the grass line channel is an intermittent stream?
Whether it has a riparian buffer to it.
Yeah, because it's an intermittent stream, but an enclosed or, you know, contained would. But is that grass line channel man-made?
Yes.
So there's nothing that's being altered. Everything you're altering or redirecting involves a man-made channel, whether it's a swale or a pipe or something covered over. There's nothing that's is anything natural here?
No, it's a man-made channel, correct.
All of it.
I have nothing further. Just request the exhibits be made part of the record.
Any questions from the board?
No.
All right. Any questions or comments from the audience? No? Then we'll close the testimony on this. Charlie, would you like to take it?
Yeah, I would give him a special exception under 280-69G. They're not really not doing anything natural. It's all man-made, so just enclosing it so they can build over it.
Enclosing a man-made...
Yes, channel.
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 I agree.
It just, should we do that as a special exception? Or if it's all man-made, I think it's outside of the riparian definition.
However you would like to word it.
Normally I don't like to take a definitional route.
If we took a definitional route, then I wouldn't have to come back to you and ask you for an extension if you took a definitional route. Remember, we already came back one time on this one and asked for an extension because of all the land development,
like
DEP stuff.
Stuff unless they're entitled to it, but from the testimony, I think definitionally that's where they are. So it'll be a definition, it'll be an interpretation, and that doesn't have to come back again.
That works, John. Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any more business? Jim, any words of wisdom? Trash pile.
Final words, we are adjourned. Thank you.
Here's some more trash.
What a night. You earned it tonight.
Yeah, we earned our pay tonight.